WIMP components for interaction. So WIMP stands for Windows Icon Menu and Pointer. Pointer in the sense mostly it is mouse, or it can be touch-based interfaces, right? So the idea here, the whole idea behind this subject is to understand some of the theory and justifications when we are going to suggest some interfaces. So these things we are going to learn now will help you in answering part two of the questions, or sometimes some of these might also come in the MCQ as some statement type questions related to this WIMP. Okay, Windows Icon Menu and Pointer. So starting with Windows, you know, windows are areas of the screen that behave as if they were independent terminals in their own right. That means now what we are seeing here is a window. What we see here, this is another window. So these are like independent terminals. Terminals means their own screens, different screens, right? So that's the nature of windows. That's what they are trying to explain here. So windows are areas of the screen that behave as if they were independent terminals in their own right. Window can usually contain text or graphics and can be moved and resized. So you can move it like this. We can minimize, we can maximize, we can resize as we need. So this is the nature of windows. More than one window can be on a screen at once. As we already see, there are many windows there, allowing separate tasks to be visible at the same time. Users can direct their attention to the different window as they switch from one thread of work to another, right? So we are able to keep this open and then open another one and start working on that. Again, if you want to switch back, we can use the mouse to switch back. Or as you know, using our keyboard also, like if you press Alt-Tab, you can do that. Or sometimes Control-Tab, no. Yeah, so this is Windows tab. So like that, different ways we can switch between the windows. Right. So let me maximize that. So users can direct their attention to the different windows as they switch from one thread of work to another. If one window overlaps the other, the back window is partially obscured. Obscured means it's kind of partially hidden, and then refreshed when exposed again. So we have that effects already in the operating system. Now let's say when this PDF window, if you see here, it is inactive. So that is called partially obscured. When I bring that forward, now this PowerPoint and other ones will become obscured. See, the color change is there, which indicates that it is inactive, right? So that is that point they mentioned there. So overlapping windows can cause problems by obscuring vital information. So windows may also be tiled when they adjoin, but do not overlap each other. So there is this thing called we can have certain things overlapped like this. And now, for example, what happens now when you're having two windows like this, we can't see the information at the back. So for that, we have a feature in operating systems, in older operating systems like Windows 7, Windows XP and all, you had this cascading and stacking. So here also we have the same thing. Now here when they're saying tiled, now for example, if you look at this view, I will switch to this view. See, so this is one way of looking at everything in once, all the windows, but it is very small, right? Also, now we have a nice feature where you can go to the history of what documents we opened in the past. It gives an overview, right? But I'll just come back. Apart from that, you can even look at windows as stacked here. It is already there. So let me put cascade. Let me open a couple of things here. So three windows are open. Skype is also there. When I put cascade windows, see what happens. So it has opened all the windows and nicely arranged it in a nice way. Right. So this will make me easier to, you know, go through. So everything is on top of each other. Right. So that is called cascade. So I cascade the windows. Another one is there, showing the windows stacked. So stacked means something like this. You put one on top of the other, like this. So if there is no space here, it comes here and it keeps on adding like this. The other one is showing side by side, right? Now for example, if I want only this PDF and this PowerPoint side by side, I'll just minimize the rest. I had to give it stacked. I think I had to put it like this. Or simply I can just drag my window this side and it will put it to the side. And then I can just open the other one on this side. So these are some flexibilities you see. So you can cascade, you can stack them, you can put it side by side. All options are available. Okay. So that is what is given here. In some system, this layout policy is fixed. In others, it can be selected by the user. So when you are describing about the facilities of Windows, you can discuss these points, how it is helping the user. Also, Windows provide scroll bars. Allow the user to move the contents of the window up and down or from side to side. You have that horizontal vertical scroll bar. This makes the window behave as if it were a real window onto a much larger world where new information is brought into view by manipulating the scroll bars. There is usually a title bar attached to the top of a window, identifying it to the user, and there may be special boxes in the corners of the window for resizing, closing, or making largest possible. We have already discussed all that, right? So you have this title bar here, you have this resizing special controls here, where you can do close, restore, maximize, minimize, everything, right? In addition, some systems allow windows within windows. For example, Microsoft Office applications such as Excel and Word, each application has its own window, and then within this, each document has a window, right? So this is like you open a window within a window. We sometimes call it as, what is that called? MDI. We call this, I'll write it down here, MDI windows. MDI stands for Multiple Document Interface, Multiple Document Interface Model, right? Now, to understand, you might have seen, for example, if I open Excel, if I open Excel, and let's say I open a blank workbook, and at the same time I open, let's see, another one here. Now you will see, although it shows us two different files, that is the two different worksheets I opened, in general I see only one Excel. Okay, so here it's shown as one. Now let me close this. process. So, I think they have now removed that feature. Basically, what happens is you have one Excel program, but within one Excel, you will have the multiple files open. So when you close one file, the other files remain, something like that. Maybe in the new version, they have removed that feature. So such kind of interface is known as MDI. So you open a window, within a window, you have multiple windows. I don't know whether there's a good example I can show you on the internet. Okay, let me close this. Multiple document interface. Yeah, this kind of, so many programs have this feature. And now in Visual Studio, IntelliJ, here for example, you have one big window. Internally, you will have the child windows. So when you close these child windows, nothing happens to the parent window, right? So this is another facility provided for, with these Windows-based interfaces. So how people can do related work in separate windows, but they will be minimized. So when you are minimizing, sometimes it will come and stay in the parent window itself. So I hope you get the idea there. So that is what is mentioned here. Next one, icons. So icons, you already know, small picture is used to represent a closed window. And this representation is known as an icon. So the in the desktop and all, you see many small images. So those are indicating it is a closed window. So when you click, when you double click, or when you press enter, when it is selected, it is kind of maximizing that program. So by allowing icons, many windows can be available on the screen at the same time, ready to be expanded to their full size by clicking on the icon. Shrinking a window to its icon is known as iconifying the window. So what they are telling is, now sometimes what happens is, for example, let me show you another example. So here, you can see Skype is running, right? Now when I minimize Skype, it is going to the taskbar here, right? Or maybe it shows here also. The general idea is it is minimized. So this is called iconifying. So when I click again, that gets active, right? Similarly, now Microsoft Outlook is not opened here. Now if I just double click on this, my Outlook application is open. But when I minimize, it is iconifying back to this location. Right? So that's the word they're using, iconifying. Shrinking a window to its known to its icon is known as iconifying the window. When a user temporarily does not want to follow a particular thread of dialogue, he can suspend that dialogue by iconifying the window containing the dialogue, similar to what I showed in Outlook. The icon saves space on the screen and serves as a reminder to the user that he can subsequently resume the dialogue by opening up the window. So this is an advantage of using an icon, right? It saves a lot of space on this. Otherwise, what happens if you don't have the concept of icons, you will have a lot of windows filling your desktop. So icons can take many forms. They can be realistic representations of the objects that they stand for, or they can be highly stylized. They can even be arbitrary symbols, but these can be difficult for users to interpret, right? So mostly you will see icons will have these kind of pictures. Now people who are already familiar with some of the notations will know what is it. Now suddenly, for example, now this one, we may not know, or maybe this one, we may not know what is the meaning of these two. So sometimes, so this is the downside of using icons. So there is a challenge of familiarity or learning curve is there when you introduce new icons. Now, so these are either representing the relevant programs, but nowadays you have a extended version of icons called live tiles. Now, if you notice in Windows 10, I click on the start menu, you will see these things. So these are also icons, but we call them tiles. The difference is they are now dynamic. Now icons are now here, these icons, no, these are static ones. But these type of icons, these are also representing some program or some window, but they provide live information. Now, if you look at this, it is providing a weather information, live information. So here something is changing. It's giving some advertisement kind of thing, right? So these are called live tiles, live tiles. So this is the modern version of icons, okay? So we have to be aware of those changes as well when we are discussing about icons. Next one, pointers. So pointers are simply the most common way of interacting with the computer system. The interaction style required by WIMP relies very much on pointing and selecting things such as icons. So we use the mouse, trackball, joystick for the for using these pointers. So the user is presented with a cursor on the screen that is controlled by the input device, right? So the user is presented with a cursor on the screen that is controlled by the input device. So you might have seen different types of cursors appearing when we use the different type of programs, right? So when you are using such pointers, the different shapes of cursor are often used to distinguish modes. Mode means, for example, the normal pointer cursor may be an arrow, but change to crosshairs when drawing a line. Now, for example, even this case, when I'm using this laser pointer, you can see, now if I just go and remove it off, it changes back to an arrow. But for the purpose I need, I can change it into anything I want, right? Pen, so it goes more smaller. So this crosshair means there is a type of crosshair cursor you might have been familiar with. When you're drawing a line, imagine it will be very difficult if you show a arrow mark. So crosshair icon, there is this thing you are already familiar. It changes into some kind of a bullet kind of thing, like this. So when you are drawing the line, you don't get confused. You know where your mouse is going to point or where it is going to start, the starting point and the ending point. So such kind of considerations are there when you are designing pointers. So the whole point what they are trying to mention here is basically when you are drawing a, when you are going to implement a program or software, and on your interface you can decide which cursor is more suitable for that scenario, and you have to introduce that cursor at that particular interaction. So cursors are also used to tell the user about system activity. For example, you know that we use a watch or an hourglass cursor or this kind of circling thing when you want to say system is busy. Pointer cursors are like icons, being small bitmap images, but in addition, all cursors have a hotspot, right? Whatever the icon you use for the cursor, right, each cursor has a hotspot. Hotspot means the exact XY coordinates. Now, when I move here and when I use the pen, when I'm going to click here, it is going to start at a particular XY point. And when I keep drawing, it is drawing in on those relevant XY points, right? So those, that exact point is known as hotspot, right? That exact point is known as the hotspot. Sometimes the hotspot is not clear from the appearance of the cursor, in which case users will find it hard to click on small targets. So imagine if you have a this thing. Now I cannot say exactly in this case whether the arrow marks pointing part is the hotspot or the middle of the cursor is the hotspot. It's very difficult. It might confuse people, right? So in that case, we have to be sure which is our hotspot. For that only we sometimes use these crosshair type of cursors. When designing your own cursors, make sure the image has an obvious hotspot. So that is up to the designer who is going to introduce a new type of cursor. Right. Next is menu. Menu, already we have seen in the last class as well. Menu, an interaction technique that is common across many windowing systems as well. A menu presents a choice of operations or services that can be performed by the system at a given time. Our ability to recall information is inferior to our ability to recognize it from some visual cue. So it gives a hint. Visual cue means it gives a hint by looking at a menu. Menus provide information cues in the form of an ordered list of operations that can be scanned. This implies that the names used for the commands in the menu should be meaningful and informative. It should be familiar also. Familiarity is also another aspect. So when you're listing the set of items in a menu, it should be appearing in a ordered list. So how do we navigate a menu? We use a pointing device. It is used to indicate the desired option. As the pointer moves to the position of a menu item, the item is usually highlighted to indicate that it is the potential candidate for selection, right? As you already know, now if I right click on this one, you can see when I'm moving my cursor, you can see it is nicely highlighting my choice, right? So that is one thing. Or sometimes you use the keyboard instructions as well. Now, for example, here, if you notice this right click menu, or we call it context menu. Now, in case my mouse doesn't work, now if I want to go to the next slide, there are a couple of options. One is PowerPoint will allow me to click. Now it does, now my arrow marks don't work. I can't go front or back. Only my menu is active now. So this is another thing of consideration. When you have a menu open, your background window gets kind of inactive automatically. Right. So now the active interface is this menu. Now if I want to go to the next one, either I have to go to this option and press enter, or simply what I can do is, you can notice there is a underline in the end. So I can press N now. It goes to the next. Right. So this is what they are saying here. So as the pointer moves to the position of a menu item, the item is usually highlighted by inverse video or some similar strategy to indicate that it is the potential candidate for selection. Selection usually requires some additional use action, such as pressing a button on the mouse that controls the pointer cursor on the screen, or pressing some special key on the keyboard. Menus are inefficient when they have too many items, and so cascading menus are utilized, in which item selection opens up another menu adjacent to the item, allowing refinement of the selection. For what they're saying is, now if you have a right click menu, you can see now this is a reasonable list, but if you have lot of things, lot of items, this menu doesn't have space. For that we introduce this kind of cascading menus where you go different levels, right, based on the option you choose. So that's what they're saying as cascading menus. The additional menus we try to put into the same menu, the additional items. So we group them. Normally when we use cascading, we are grouping certain items as one group. The user can easily go and use that. Right, so I hope that was clear. So the main menu can be visible to the user all the time as a menu bar, and submenus can be pulled down or across from it upon request. Menu bars are often placed at the top of the screen, for example in macOS, or at the top of each window in Microsoft Windows. You know, normally our menus are at the top. Now, nowadays we don't see menus in Office applications. We have this concept of ribbon. Now even in the File Explorer window, you will see you don't have menus. These are ribbons, ribbon interface. Actually, these were the earlier days menus, right? If you still want to see a menu, I think you have it in Notepad. Right, so this is what is the original menu. So this concept has now evolved into ribbons. And you have the ribbon groups. These are called ribbon groups. Okay, so that's the modern version of menus today. So websites use a variety of menu bar locations, including top, bottom, and either side of the screen. Today's websites, you might have noticed that you will see it on the top or sometimes in the side. You expand it, right? Alternatively, the main menu can be hidden, and upon request, it will pop up onto the screen. So these pop-up menus are often used to present context-sensitive options. For example, allowing one to examine properties of particular on-screen objects. Right. So this is like pop-up menu means on demand. Sometimes when you need only, it will come. Right? You might have seen if you click on a button, sometimes a menu just appears on that spot. The other type of navigation menus I'll show is here. For example, if you look at this one, now you have this concept of this is called a burger icon, right? You might have seen in the most of the websites, or sometimes when you're accessing modern websites on your mobile phone, most of the menus get collapsed to this one. So like for example, if I expand this, see, I see the extended information. So if I collapse it back, it goes back. Basically, it's the same thing. These same icons, when I expand, it shows in detail. Otherwise, I can just minimize them. So when I'm expanding, you can see my regular start menu items are hidden. Right? So this is another way of thinking. If you visit material design, there are plenty of menu options. You will see how people are doing. Let's see if I can show you one quick menu option. This should work. Until that loads, let me go ahead, come back and show you some new type of, all what we were discussing, how they are now supported in the modern designs, right? Or how they have changed is what we have. So basically having an idea about these things are important. So menus come in different varieties. Pull down menus are dragged down from the title at the top of the screen by moving the mouse pointer into the title bar area and pressing the button, so something like this. Fall down menus are similar, except that the menu automatically appears when the mouse pointer enters the title bar without the user having to press the button. That is called fall down menus. You might have experienced that as well. Some menus are pin-up menus, in that they can be pinned to the screen, staying in place until explicitly asked to go away. Now in title bars and all, you can pin some icons, you might have noticed that. For example, if I, now this is pinned, I can now even move the location of this, So this is also another pin. If I don't want this icon in the bar, actually this is not open now, this is closed. But I can still keep them anywhere in my taskbar. If I don't want, I can just right click, unpin. So this is another special type of menu. Pop-up menus appear when a particular region of the screen may be designated by an icon is selected, but they only stay as long as the mouse button is depressed. So certain places you might have seen, it opens up the thing, but until you go and close that menu, it doesn't go away. That is called pop-up menu. Another advanced type of menus you might have seen in certain interfaces, especially touch screens and all, certain arrangements, the icons are arranged in a circular way, or like you will see it in these kind of ways, right? So the reason is why it is advantageous to have something in a circular fashion is there is the same distance to travel to any of the selections, right? Same distance to travel to any of the selections. You don't have to move here and there. So that explains also Fitts' law. What is the Fitts' law explaining? We have learned that. If you haven't learned, I'll just give you a quick point in the book, where you can find what is Fitts' law, because in the past paper also you have a question about it. Let me open it. So Fitts' law is a mathematical formula which relates the time required to move to a target as a function of the distance to the target and the size of the target itself. So it's going to talk about the time related to the distance of the target you have to move and the size of the target. Say moving a pointer using a mouse to a particular button, right? So let's say there is a button on this particular area, and this is the formula how much time it will take to move your cursor to that location is indicated by this formula, where k is approximately 100 milliseconds into log 2 of distance over size plus 0.5. The whole log is multiplied by this 100 milliseconds. So what it says is, you can, as simple mathematics we know, we have learned. So d is the distance between the current cursor position and the target, and s is the size of the target. So let's say your button is somewhere here and your mouse is here. Now if I want to move my mouse from here to here, how much time it will take is dependent on this formula. So that is dependent on the distance and the size of the target. So what this says is, if the distance is larger, it's going to take more time. At the same time, if the size of the target, say the button size is also going to be very smaller, then also it's going to take time, right? So what Fitts' law describes is motor control. The smaller the target, so as long as the target is very, very smaller, and the greater the distance, and if this is going to be high and this is going to be low, it's going to take a lot of time. Simple fraction you can see, for example, 1/2, let's say, you may know simple mathematics, right? Let's say you have a formula like this. A is equal to B upon C, right? So if C is going to be larger, A is going to be less. At the same time, if B is going to be larger, A is also going to be proportional to that. It's also going to be larger. So same theory applies in the fixed law as well. If your distance is going to be larger, the time taken to move is also going to be higher or large. If the size of the target is going to be larger, the time taken to move to that is going to be less. Or opposite way, if the target is going to be very small, so totally this becomes big, right? So that is what is Fitch's law is explaining. You should be able to, I mean, you don't have to write out this formula. You can explain simply this particular point here. Smaller the target and the greater the distance, the longer it will take to hit the target, right? So you will get a, definitely there will be a question on Fitch's law. You'll have to be aware of how to explain. So you might get an example by giving a scenario. Then you have to, they'll also ask, can you explain this in a reasonable way? And then you can introduce, according to Fitch's law, this is the point. Larger the target, it's going to take more time or less time to access it. So this has the advantage that it is easier to select items since they can each have a larger target area, and that the selection time for each item is the same since the pointer is equidistant from the menu. So this is, they are talking about the circular menu. Everything is closer and equal distance from a particular location. Compare this with the standard menu. Remembering Fitch's law, we can see that it will take longer to select items near the bottom of the menu than at the top. So from moving here to here, you will see there will be a time consideration, right? Or even if you have a menu, for example, if I want to go to the, let's say this ensure thing, from here to here, it takes some time to do. But if it is next to this, like a circular fashion, it's going to take less time. So that's the point they're mentioning. However, these pie menus, or this round thing is called pie, as they are known, take up more screen space and are therefore less common in interfaces. So that's some additional point they are discussing, right? Like it's not a disadvantage, actually a downside of using this, because you need a lot of space for this. But in a menu, simply, you know, it's very less compact. So that is what they're telling you. Now, certain places you have this keyboard accelerators, as I showed you here, where I had to, when I'm having this menu active, my other windows are now not active, and any of the other keys will not work except the letters that are underlined here, right? Only those letters will be active on my keyboard. Now, for example, if I click on I, there is nothing related to I. I don't think anything happened. See, nothing happens. I'm pressing I. Or if I press 8, no. If I press 1, nothing happens, right? So we have to be aware of this. When you are designing an interface for a user also, you have to kind of make this informed for the user. Now there will be sometimes some kind of confusion. Now if you look at this one, now some menus you will see, you will have this underline as well as a special key, F3. Now how do you differentiate which one will work at which time, right? Now to understand this, let me go to Notepad. I think I have Notepad here. Yeah. Now, okay. Now I have clicked on File. Okay, let's say here. Okay, now at the moment I don't see that accelerator key. Now when I pressed Alt, you'll see. Can you see the underline appearing? Now I'm pressed Alt. Now F is having underline, Edit is having underline, Format is. Now in this mode, just like that right menu, if I press on 8, nothing happens, but it disappears because it's trying to come back to the normal mode. When I press Alt again, you will see now only those letters are active. Now let's say if I try to press V, that view menu. Let me alter. See, that view menu appeared. Then I went to, if I want to go to Zoom, I have to press Z again. Right? Now, you have a confusion here. Now, in these three items, you will see, now there are a couple of ways to do this, whether I use Z or Control plus or Control minus. So what does this say? Now when I press Z, it's just going between the two options because both are highlighting Z. So if I really want to zoom this in, at this point, I can't use the Z. I have to use the Control plus. So maybe I have to select that, but Control plus, see, even without showing the menu, I'm doing that. Then Control minus, this is showing this. So we have to be aware when we are showing something like this, we have to be aware. Now in this case, this part is not active. In this menu, whatever was underlined was only active. So that is the point they are telling in this slide. So menus often offer keyboard accelerators. Bring back the pointer. Menus often offer keyboard accelerators, key combination that have the same effect as selecting the menu item. This allows more expert users. So keyboard accelerators is this thing which I mentioned. So this allows more expert users familiar with the system to manipulate things without moving off the keyboard, which is often faster. The accelerators are often displayed alongside the menu items so that frequent use makes them familiar. Unfortunately, most systems don't allow you to use the accelerators while the menu is displayed. Sorry, so accelerator is basically the other side part. So for example, so what do you mean by accelerator doing something quick through the keyboard? So without the use of mouse. Now, for example, now when you are cut, copy, pasting also, you don't always use the mouse. You just make the selection using shift key. You press Control A, then Control C, Control V, right? So these are accelerators. But when you show them in a menu, they are not active, right? So that's what they're saying in this example. However, when the user presses function key F3, when this menu is active, nothing happens, as we saw earlier. F3 only works when the menu is not displayed. When the menu is there, you must press F instead. So this kind of problem is known as dishonest. This is an example of an interface that is dishonest because it sometimes can confuse the user. When you show both key commands together, they have to be aware of the mode now, in which mode they are. So this is a challenge in user interface design. So the major problems with menus in general are deciding what items to include and how to group those items. So including too many items make menus too long or creates too many of them. Also, grouping can also cause problems in that items that relate to the same topic need to come under the same heading, yet many items could be grouped under more than one heading. So both type of challenges are there. When you have a lot of items also, you have a problem how to show all of them. But when you also grouping, sometimes you are repeating the same, the subgroup under, you may need that same thing on another group as well. So it's like you're duplicating the effort. So that kind of challenge is there. So in pull-down menus, the menu label should be chosen to reflect the function of the menu items and items grouped within menus by function. So what they are saying is, you divide when you're having this pull-down menus, like in the notepad we saw, related functions should be grouped together, right? These groupings should be consistent across applications so that user can transfer learning to new application, right? It should be consistent. Menu items should be ordered in the menu or according to importance and frequency of use. And opposite functionality should be far away, should be kept apart, right? So this example of grouping and keeping apart. Now, if you look at this ribbon interface, in the home screen, you can see there is a thing called clipboard. So clipboard functionality, this cut, copy, paste, formatting all comes under this. Imagine cut is here and copy is somewhere in another one. That will be very difficult. You have to find it. If you don't have this grouping arrangement, it will be very difficult for the user to find. So here, look at this find, replace, selection. These are related functionality. So they are under the group called editing. So early days, that will be under menu as well. So here also you can see under edit, see cut, copy, paste together, right? And example of keeping opposite functionalities separately is like this. You have new here, exit at the bottom. Imagine if exit was here, what will happen? By mistakenly, if the user comes and clicks, because people are not accurate, people can make mistakes. It will be very difficult experience. So that's why the opposite functionality should be very far. So new, exit, it's very separate. Sometimes, like if you look at certain menus, you will see that kind of functionality, right? So that's what they are saying here. So menu items should be ordered in the menu according to importance and frequency of use. And opposite functionalities such as save, delete should be kept apart to prevent accidental selection of wrong function with potentially disastrous consequences. So WIMP interface, the main components, Windows icon menu pointer we discussed. Now what are the other supportive components that are available that support this particular interaction? Buttons. Buttons are individual and isolated regions within a display that can be selected by the user to invoke specific operations. These regions are referred to as buttons because they are purposely made to resemble the push buttons you would find on a control button. So pushing the button invokes a command, the meaning of which is usually indicated by a textual label or a small icon. Normally buttons have that. Buttons can also be used to toggle between two states. Now, some places you can't use the flag button if you have a functionality where you want to change between one state to another state, right? So in that case, you might have seen, now for example, this bold, italic, underline functionality you have used in Microsoft Office. What happens is, same button, it changes its appearance. Like it gives you an impression that it is pressed, right? That is one thing. Or sometimes you can group that functionality to do the same thing, to set of mutually exclusive options, such as the size in points of the current form. So we call them radio buttons, right? Some are not mutually exclusive. That means you have more than one option to do. In that case, we use checkboxes, right? See this one. So if you have a need to group certain things and only choose one of the many options, you will go for radio button. So this is different from a standard button, which we normally see, because standard button does only one functionality. But here you have the option of choosing either one of many options. In that case, you introduce a radio button. Or if you have a place where you want to do more than one option, which is not mutually exclusive. That's what they're saying, not mutually exclusive. Let's say you want to do bold, italic, underline all together. In that case, you will use toggle buttons. Checkboxes. Right? It's a special type of toggle button. Toolbars, today we don't see toolbars, that's why we have ribbons now, but just for the learning purpose. Many systems have a collection of small buttons, so important thing is to understand why toolbars are there, right? The function of this toolbar is similar to a menu bar, but as the icons are smaller than the equivalent text, more functions can be simultaneously displayed. So earlier Windows interfaces have this iconized version of the same menu. You had the menu here, At the same time, you had the toolbar here, where it gives the same functionality in certain icons, the important ones. Sometimes the content of the toolbar is fixed, but often users can customize it, either changing which functions are made available or choosing which of several predefined toolbars are displayed. Okay. In many application programs, interaction can enter one of several modes. The defining characteristic of modes is that interpretation of actions, such as keystrokes or gestures with the mouse, changes as the mode changes. We discussed earlier. User has to be aware of which mode he is in. Now, if I'm using this now, currently the slide is active. Now, when I introduce the menu, now my menu is active, but the behind thing is now disabled, right? So we have to be aware in which mode we are in. How do we show that to the user, which one is active, which is inactive, right? So that example they are given. For example, in a standard Unix text editor, or let's say in Microsoft Notepad, keystrokes can be interpreted either as operations to insert characters in the document. It could be something we are trying to type into the main typing area, or it might be doing some functionality, command mode. So whether it is insert mode or command mode should be very clear. So problems occur if the user is not aware of the current mode, right? This happens in many, many scenarios when you are using the system. So palettes are a mechanism for making the set of possible modes and active mode visible to the user. A palette is actually usually a collection of icons that are reminiscent of the purpose of various modes. An example in a drawing package would be a collection of icons to indicate the pixel color or pattern that you use to fill in objects, much like an artist's palette for paint. So here you can see when you select a particular color here, you have this indication. That indication gives an impression to the user, this particular area is now selected. Imagine if this kind of a dark border thing is not available. You may see the changes appearing, but it will be very difficult for the user to know where he is clicked, which one he has clicked. So when you have a indicator like this, it's very easy to track for the user. So those are certain additional things as a UX designer who needs to consider. Some systems allow the user to create palettes from menus or toolbars. In the case of pull-down menus, the user may be able to tear off the menu, turning it into a palette showing the menu items. Now, some interfaces you might have seen. Now, for example, let's say I have this language. I don't know whether it will work here. I have this language thing. Now, if I try to drag this, okay, now it doesn't work. There was a thing where I could drag something and put here in an earlier systems there. Like wherever I needed, I can create a short menu from wherever the things are, right? That is one way of introducing certain pull-down menus. But nowadays you can see, you have a different type of tier of menu now in office package especially. Now my main, when I click on this, let's say this particular thing, the home ribbon gets active because it's related to formatting. It gives me an indication that I'm trying to format something. But the moment I select something, see, this menu appears. So this is a special type of tier off menu. Tier off means I have taken something out of this and tiered it off here. Right? Or simply I can just right click on it, it appears. So that is a special tier off menu. You take a subset of the main menu items onto a area you prefer. So tier of menus are usually those that are heavily graphical anyway. For example, line style or color selection in a drawing package. So it will take a lot of options there. Finally, dialog boxes. Dialog boxes are information windows used by the system to bring the user's attention to some important information, possibly an error or a warning used to prevent a possible error. Normally, these messages we see, they are called dialog boxes. Alternatively, they are used to invoke a sub-dialogue between the user and system for a very specific task that will normally be embedded within some larger tasks, right? Just as windows are used to separate different threads of user system dialogue, so too are dialogue boxes used to factor out auxiliary or secondary task threads from the main task dialogue. So what is this dialogue? For example, here you can see I have many groups here, right, in this ribbon. Now certain formatting options are available. I can change the name, the size, increase, decrease, certain other fundamental things I can do. Let's say I want to do certain advanced things for this particular selection I have made, this word called dialogue, I want to change something. You can see under this font group, you have this small small button there. If I click this, now this is called a dialogue. So one dialogue I told, messages, but this is giving the additional function. That's what this second point is showing here, sub dialogue. So here now I can do lot of things. Now, for example, now strike through, bold and all, everything is here, even those things will be available here. Like if I want to change the underline style to a different thing, additional stuff, or let's say underline color, because here you have normal underline, no? So if I want to change the underline color, let's say I select something here, if I give some yellow, click OK, it will put that. See, you can see it has put that in there. Like that, each group will have a separate special sub dialog where you can do additional functionality. Okay, so that was about the menu. Let me show you the modern Windows interaction components. This is basically a style introduced by Google, which is called material design. So these designs are now used in all modern interfaces. Already you might have been familiar with these controls, but this is the trend. When you're going to design a new web interface or a desktop interface, you have to be aware of these modern design trends. So I'll briefly show you some of them, and then we can conclude the subject. Let's see whether this is running. Material design. Right. So, see, you have this hamburger thing. If I click this, it shows me additional. This is a modern way of doing. Now let's go to this palette thing we discussed. What are the available palette options now in modern design? Now, for example, here I can change color of the whole thing. So this is one thing. We go to another one, buttons and toggles. What are the available button options now? You might have seen these different types of buttons. Now you have this notification. Now, for example, if I click, keep on clicking this, you can see the effects, what is happening. Now, if I click this, you can see notification. So I don't have to now, this is all now adhering to the Fitts law, where you have information very close, right? See, within the button we can do, if I click this, certain effects, if I click this, shows me. This is also special type of menu. Now this is a button and a menu combined together. See, icon changes, you can go to the additional selection wherever you want, right? Showing inactive menus, ripple effect, more ripple, custom ripple, dismissing. See, I have the same interface changing. I have a close button within the button itself. Right. Showing progress bar together. Right. Like this, you can see many things. Now, early days radio buttons were like this. Now you have this toggle option. See, this is also same thing, on off kind of thing. Checking. You give error messages within if you have not checked. Tabs. Bold italic. So these are all standard things we have seen. Changing the appearance of things. Right? Rating bars. See how the animations work. Like that, if you look at fields, how fields have changed today. You have this kind of field, have this long list, editable field, floating hint, you can have this. So like that, different stuff is there. Go quickly to pickers. So date thing. I want to select date here. I get the calendar. So within one, so this is another example of sub dialog. From this button, I go to the sub dialog, choose the date, click OK. It reflects here. See? Right? Showing clock interface. Now, see the nice thing about this interface is, now if I go to further, I didn't do anything, I just hold my mouse, it went to the minute level. I come out. See? Goes to the minute level. If I click on this, hour level. Right? That is a nice way of displaying things. So these are things you can explore and search. So the modern menus, how they have changed. The default context menu, I haven't seen this. How they have shown things. And this is another type of menu we see. And how we call that. Dialogues. So now you have, now if you want to add the item, it opens something within that thing. And then, let's say we put it adds it within that thing. You don't have to open a separate interface and add things. Now with these modern controls, you can do lot of additional things. The message boxes, the new type of dialog boxes. You can see how nicely now the stuff has come. Okay. Another interesting thing is draw a dialog. Now this is a new type of way of interacting. Now you see how you can give the user experience to the user. See, now if I click on this, it opens this side, left side. I close it, top. If I click on the center, all will come together. So this is another way of, you know, designing your functionality and providing ways. These were not possible in our conventional or the old type of menu or the window structure, but now these things are possible. So it's a new way of interacting, giving a new experience for the user. Expanders, you might have seen this one. How they design these things. So these are the, now you might have already seen these in websites now. So it's where you can show a lot of content with less space. Right? If you want space on your screen, you can have these kind of controls. So this is how you give the user experience. Typography, that's a different thing. And you have now modern icon packs. For each and every thing, you have a new set of icons. Okay, so those are just some of the many options that are available in modern interfaces. So it's good to consider this material design whenever you are doing your new interface designs in your applications. It will give you a nice rich look and feel. Because why I'm introducing this, why I'm showing this is, as a UX designer, we are learning user interface design. Now we have to move towards the new conventions. So although what we are learning is little bit outdated because it's for the sake of the syllabus, we have to also be aware. Now these new type of interaction modes have also come into the market. Okay, so any questions you can ask? Do you have anything? Okay, so thank you for the time.